Good evening. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. And as we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. These are the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to our conversation with Quiara, Alegría, Hudes, and John Chu, presented in partnership with Elliott Bay Book Company, Intimon Theater, and Seattle Repertory Theater. We're grateful to our author series sponsor, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and the Seattle Times for generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I have a couple quick announcements before we get started. Quiara's book, My Broken Language, is available through our friends over at Elliott Bay Book Company. They're open for limited browsing, curbside pickup, and delivery. Oh, I love it. Yeah, hold the book up. And you can find it at their website, elliottbaybook.com. And we'll be putting that link in the chat as well. And then after John and Kiara's conversation, we'll have time for questions from you. So you can ask your question at any time during the conversation by just popping it into the Q&A box that's at the bottom of your screen. And then finally, after the program, we're interested in hearing from you. We'll post a link to a program survey in the chat. We'd appreciate it if you took a minute after the event to fill that out. And now I am delighted to welcome Rick Simonson from Elliott Bay Book Company, who will introduce tonight's speakers. Hey, Rick.
Hi, Stesha. Thank you for that. Thank you, all the other organizations that have been involved with helping tonight. And to say, we had our druthers would be in the library auditorium tonight with all of us gathered. But this allows some people who are joining us from afar to do so. And in the case of both the people you hear from tonight, they are joining us from afar as Quiara, Alegría Hudes and John Chu have a conversation centered around Quiara's memoir that's just been published, My Broken Language. Most of the people coming to this at the outset would be coming because of knowing of her work as one of the foremost playwrights of our time, the author of, I believe, 10 plays, plays and musicals, including the Pulitzer winning play Water by the Spoonful, the most recent one being Miss You Like Hell. And we'll probably touch on a little bit on another work that she's known for, writing the book for the wonderful musical, award-winning musical In the Heights, which is in this form. And we'll actually later, it's gonna be talked about various ways. There's gonna be a big illustrated book of this coming out soon too, which I think will get posted as we go along. But the real reason for tonight happening, and this book has only been out 4 days now since it came out on Tuesday, My Broken Language. We were just saying beforehand, a lot of memoirs come our way. Our way meaning we in bookstores and to we readers. And you look for what distinguishes them in terms of the story there and the voice of the writing in that book. And though you would know from reading or hearing or seeing Quiara's plays that she has a great sense of language, writing a memoir is a real different form of writing. And you pick this book up and you are, I put this book in someone's hand in our bookstore today about saying what it does. And I won't babble it all here because you're going to get to hear her and John talk about this, but it really does convey a story of coming from Philadelphia, from having a childhood that at one point was sort of divided between in the city and in the country, and what was taken in that as a stage of girlhood. And then as she's more and more within the realm of her mother's family, a Puerto Rican family in West Philadelphia, just vividly written of and portrayed. And then where else she goes, school, college, high school, college, and what happens along the way, people, you know, things she has to overcome, but also those who step in and you know, give this guidance or gestures of support or direction. And all those are so vital for anyone making their way. But you also, as Quiara, you know, beautifully writes, she doesn't sort of overly do anything, but she takes it and goes with it and takes it all these places in music at Yale and then in playwriting at Brown and on into the world. And All this is just the beginning of a remarkable, saying it, a remarkable book. And I won't go on beyond this, because you will get to hear, and then you have to read this book. With Quiara tonight, John Chu, who is known, of course, as an acclaimed film director, and who's made himself almost a parallel number of films to Quiara's plays, probably most recently and most well-known for Crazy Rich Asians. And he's also done Jam and the Hologram and Now You See Me Too. And one reason for tonight's happening, they've been working together quite a bit of late. And you will see, starting on June 17th, the film release of In the Heights, and for which Quiara wrote the screenplay, and she, Lin-Manuel Miranda, and others are co-producers, and John Chu has done the directing work for us. So they bring that kind of connection and work together on this. So John's never done this before, but this is also part of the Zoom time. So we all get to do new things, as we all have been. So Stesha will come in later. And again, for all of us at Elliott Bay and for everyone else who's been involved with this, we thank you for being here. And now ask you to please give your good attention and virtual applause. And our thanks also to Quiara's mother, who's attending this tonight, to Quiara, Alegría, Hudes, and John Chu. Thank you both. Take it away.
Thanks, Rick. I've always wanted to see you say Gem in the Hologram. So you made one dream come true tonight.
Gem is truly
out. Oh, gosh. Oh, God. Quiara, so Quiara didn't just like write In the Heights. She gave it its soul, its gut, its punch. Every moment of that, we were together, and she was there before I ever got there. And so I have so much. I basically have had the pleasure and honor of listening to her for the last several years, and I feel so blessed to be nourished by her heart and see that someone so smart can have so much heart, that it's not just about head all the time. And I actually was thinking a lot about that through this book, which I wish everyone, I don't know if everyone had read this before coming here, but I mean.
Probably not,
but I wish they did, because there's so many details that I want to talk about that I can relate to. I did not come from a family like yours. I came from a Chinese immigrant family in the Bay Area, but in a lot of ways, you know, they didn't have the way you talk about your mother, the way she you talk about how she has her accent and how you try to correct her. Like, I have so many of those cringeworthy moments and things that I still have not been able to fully talk about, and your words on this page have done that. So it's like, I wish we were sitting next to a couch, because I wish I could hug you. There were moments where I was crying, moments where I'm standing up like screaming in this book. So I can't wait for everyone to read it. So hi, Quiara, how's it been going?
You know, while we're in like the praise portion of this, you know, maybe it'll last the whole time, but I just want to let everyone out there know that, you know, they've seen your films, so they know you're an extraordinary artist. I personally think that In the Heights is the most beautiful film you've made, and that's saying a lot, because I came to this project, this collaboration with you, with a tremendous amount of admiration, and I loved your work already. But the artistry is magnificent and virtuosic and singular of vision.
Thanks.
Even just putting that aside, speaking as a human who collaborated with this individual, I've worked with a lot of leaders. I didn't exactly know what leadership looked like until I met John Chu, and it was a beautiful thing to see. The amount of kind of handholding that happened with basically humility, listening, and strength all together, as those were, he was always leading with those things, the humility, the ability to listen, and yet to have a totally strong vision. It was truly gorgeous. And so I couldn't help, you know, but treat myself to asking John to do this book event with me.
Thank you. And we actually talked a lot. I think you were writing stuff while we were shooting at some, or maybe starting it. We talked a lot about language, because that show, I mean, you've spoken a lot of languages in your life. And that was what was really fun about reading this book. from the stories about when you got your first typewriter to your first upright piano. Like, to me, those were so fascinating. How do you even, maybe this is not a great question, but like, I guess when you call something a memoir, how truthful is it? And how do you even start that process? Because I'm all about process, as you know, creatively. How did you first go about it?
Well, I've always felt that my family's story is incredible. You know, I talk about being an adolescent and sitting on the steps at Abuela's house and watching them dance and watching them play bingo and knowing the suffering that's happening in their hearts at the same time as they're celebrating life and living in their bodies. When I say they, I'm talking about my cousins, my tías, my abuela, my family. So watching it and thinking, this is the best book I've never read. You know, to me, this was the American story, and it was stunning. And yet, seeing our complete lack of representation in my English classes in high school, in the movies that I was renting from West Coast Video, you know, on VHS tape, and also at the same time, seeing the way Latino communities were portrayed outside of the communities, that was harmful. It was a real mismatch. So I think I've always known, okay, I need to tell our stories. I want to tell our stories. It's important. We are part of history. We are part of this nation's history, and it must be recorded. As to the process for this book, you know, Joyce Carol Oates, the writer, she talks about inspiration is like when the moment the lit match gets dropped into the bucket of kerosene. And for me, that lit match was just popping in a DVD of an old celebration we had on July 4th in 1991. And it was sweltering. It's North Philly at my abuela's house. And that was the year that Juan Luis Guerra's groundbreaking album, Bachata Rosa, came out. And so these row homes are tiny. There's a lot of cousins packed in. The bodies are in motion. The bodies are sweating together. There's kisses on foreheads. There's blessings. There's hugs. It's so physical. And to see that and to remember, to see the beauty of all that motion. And it's just like people are wearing like bike shorts and sports bras because it's so hot, you know, so there's a lot of skin showing, a lot of different body types and body shapes showing. And it was joyous. It was utter joy. And to see that DVD, it had been transferred to a DVD. It was first on VHS. And to remember what also was happening in our family that year, which was me not understanding why am I going to so many funerals of my loved ones who are my contemporaries, not my elders. There was a lot of loss in the community at that time from HIV, from addiction, from gun violence, which we're still facing today. And remembering that, but seeing the joy, that was a match. Mm-hmm. And that was the book. It was not going to just to be about the suffering, but about the joy and the resilience and the embodiment, how we danced towards tomorrow.
I think that's what I love about it, is there is so much love inside of it. There's so much tragedy, but there's so much love. And it's not naive love. It's not simple solutions. In fact, there is not a solution. It just, it's life. It keeps rolling. And when you talk about seeing the bodies rubbed up against each other and you're just like the observer watching it, I mean, when I was young, watching my family, not understanding all the words, but getting a lot of the words and understanding what they meant, even if I didn't understand the words, eating, and knowing that at some point I was going to be, I wanted to tell that story as well through pictures. Like, I see you through all of those moments. And you're in such an interesting position being first generation here. I think we all are. I think this is like the moment that we're trying to meet. I think you said at one point, within all the mismatch and chaos, I could be both interloper and core constituent, a tug and pull I knew well, being of two cultures. I feel that too.
You know, another reason for the why now is thinking about like that first generation here situation. You know, it's a lot to leave behind.
Yeah.
The air humidity, you know, the neighbors you know, the flavors you know, the groceries and local harvests that you know, to leave that all behind and go to a new place, especially in the case of my family, we were earth people, we were farmers, and all of a sudden we're in North Philly. And as gentrification happens, it pushes us farther and farther out to neighborhoods where there aren't even, there's not even green space, there's not even a tree on the block. Yeah. So to go in a matter of 5 years from being really earth people to concrete people, that's shocking. And there's a lot of survival involved in that, you know? And I don't have those same survival needs. So I'm in a place where I can kind of look and tell a little bit more. I have more space in my life to look back and to look forward, not just from a place of survival, but from a place of like, here's what we did, here's who we were, here's who we are, what's next?
And it's like the tools in order to communicate what that feels like is in the language. I mean, is literally all these languages you have to learn. I feel like in the beginning, I think you literally make a prayer about, please help me understand, make this language make sense or something like that. As a structure, just in a story, to watch you become versed, discover language, discover music, discover even authors as you read it. I mean, the way you describe that, it's just so beautiful. And then you suddenly becomes your superpower. I'll probably just tell you all the parts that I like just this whole time, but it moves me because, again, we don't have the words. I don't have the words to say that. So it's you have this massively organized messiness in it. And I love that it's like that.
Yes, that feels like my existence. I mean, the reason it's called My Broken Language is because I have this language problem, which is that I don't speak Spanish. I don't think in Spanish. I don't dream in Spanish. And I don't speak it with the fluency of my mother. My mother and I have different mother tongues, let alone my abuela, my tías, my cousins. Some of them were born there and some of them were born here. So depending, we have English or Spanish as the first language. So I was already like a little bit, my Spanish felt broken, and English, which I was born into and also gained more and more mastery of as I become in love with literature, it doesn't have all the vocabulary to describe my truth. It's insufficient in and of itself as a language to describe who I am, who we are, what my history is, to tell my world. So that's a conundrum. And really what I do is I take these broken languages and I look for more. I start studying music. Those languages, the language of Bach and Coltrane and Ramito, who is a Puerto Rican troubadour. He wrote the song famously, Que Bonita Bandera. You know, all of these become new languages to me. I start studying visual languages. I go to the Philadelphia Art Museum and look at the Duchamps, which are crazy contemporary art, well, modern art, in the Western idiom. And then I'm looking at my mother, who is a priest in Lucumí, more popularly known as Santeria. She's a priest, and we have these stunning altars that it looks like in holy installation art in my sunroom. And I don't have the vocabulary to parse it all. So I have to study, I have to keep going deeper. And I take these kind of broken languages and I try to make my own language out of them. And by the end, the book ends when I think I do it.
Yeah. It seems like also at this moment, words really aren't enough to communicate through cultures and what we're going through around the country, around the world, as we're like meeting each other through technology and coming face to face. Do you think that thinking about language in this way came from the time, or you've always been thinking about these different languages?
I wasn't able to articulate it until I wrote this book, to be honest, but once the thought came to me, it was clear that that had always been a deep curiosity of mine, an organizing principle of my life, but not in a way that I was self-aware of, just in a way I was diving into. You know, and what you're saying about the limitations of language that we're all dealing with right now, one of the big languages in the book is body language. There's many chapters dedicated to body language. And actually, I say, you know, at Abuela's house, bodies were the mother tongue, with Spanish second and English third, because bodies didn't get lost in translation. Mm-hmm. You know, and I talk about our touch. I talk about our lack of shame surrounding our different body types, very full figured, wrinkly, smooth, able-bodied, surgically
scars,
you know, I saw it all because my elders would get dressed around me. They'd walk around in the heat in their underwear when it was hot, because there was AC in Abuela's room, but not in the rest of the house. Mm-hmm. And they didn't seem like ashamed of the ways their body were non-traditional, i.e. natural. In like, they weren't following Vogue's instructions about, you know, how you should look. They were being themselves. And that was very moving to me and formative for me. So the body language being one of those central languages.
I love that you even were like, you know, you basically took down the word fat. You're like, fat, there's like so many different words that make that beautiful, you know, like the form and the shape, and like, screw saying fat. Like, it was just so cool to it just reforms those things. I mean, I came from, I think this is a story from your mom, when the kids would call and say whore. And then your mom said something about, I think I have it here somewhere, said something about, you know what, how you, what that is. Hold on, I'm gonna find it, because it's so freaking good. Hold on. I just love that you twist language in a way that makes it empowering. And I think that is survival. That we have to tell ourselves stories. What I've got from your book is sometimes we have to tell ourselves our story in order to know that this is a moment in a bigger story of this. Okay, here it is. So it goes, ho, it's an ancient tool with a sharp ball for clearing and turning the soil. When the earth gets tired, you break the earth, you wound the earth, digging narrow troughs and trenches so you can do what? Plant seeds. They think they're shaming me, but they have no clue that they're praising me. We are not whores, we are hoes. And I just think that's so empowering.
Yes, so one of the really joyous parts of the book to write was how my mother's broken English, because it was her second language, though her professional life was half in English. She worked in the community, but also with English-speaking coworkers too. But mm-hmm. But her, you know, her broken English actually like led to innovation. Like, she was a language innovator. So in the way that she can hear the word whore, and this was, she kept getting a crank call calling her a whore, and I was answering, it's like, your mother's a whore, and it was very upsetting to me. And all of a sudden, she's praising this guy and saying, thank you for the message. I'm like, what are you talking about? This is very upsetting. They're slandering you. And she said, well, think of that. How do you say whore in el barrio? I'm like, puta, I don't know. You know, she said, okay, how else? Ho? Yeah, and what else is a ho? You know, and then we get to this gardening tool, returning to the fact that we are people of the farm. We are people of the earth. And we break the tired earth to renew it. And to plant new seeds. And she was doing that with the language. Like, I'm sorry, but as a native English speaker, I would have never come up with that beautiful association. She could hear the language in a different way that was dizzying and exciting to me. Mm-hmm.
Your mom is a force. I mean, that, I can't wait to hang with her. The energy, everything she's done in her life, what she taught you, even the carrying the memories of our past, of the suffering of our past, I think is so fascinating that it's like in our DNA. I don't know. It's actually, it puts the, you know, because we all feel the weight of our ancestors when we're here, but it puts that in a different context. Like, it's not something that's put upon us. It is us to make that space for us.
You know, we feel the weight of them, and we also feel the levity of them too. And it is nice to know that I have this benevolent parade marching behind me, which is them. One of the other elements of the book that contributes to all these broken languages and to my kind of confusion, but amazement and curiosity at the world is growing up in, I don't know if saying in the shadow of, but growing up kind of in awe of a larger than life parent. And I think kind of it's more traditional in memoirs and in stories that that parent would maybe be abusive or difficult. That wasn't the case here. It's just that my mother had a very distinct and profound gift that was somewhat awesome to behold and that I did not share, which is the language of the spirits. That's another one of the languages. So she told me when I was, you know, yay high, about her own life at five, the first times the spirits started speaking to her. And then she continued to tell me about these things. And she asked, did I have that gift? Had the dead ever come and spoken to me? I did not have that gift. And at five, I thought, my mother is different and special and in a way that I don't have. And she kind of looked at me when I said, no, I never had that experience. And she looked at me and she said, oh, don't worry, you got something. Then being a teenager and as her spiritual pursuits, you know, she did not have the opportunity to graduate from college, but her education continued, her self-education through her spiritual pursuits. So to become a priest in Lukumi, she had to work very hard and study very rigorously. And she shared some of those studies with me. I could understand the books, but I couldn't understand it when I walked downstairs and witnessed my mother's body in spirit possession. I had never seen anything like that, let alone experienced anything like that. Mm-hmm. She was speaking differently. She was like a man. Her voice was different. And in the book, that's when I say that prayer that you mentioned earlier. I say, God, give me the language to even make sense of my life. What is this? Mm-hmm. And I'm looking at my mom going through that experience and saying, you know, she's not mine. And she never was. She's hers and she's the spirit's, but she was never mine. I had to earn her because she had this amazing gift. So I studied more. I studied the languages more. I studied Lukumi and she helped me with those studies. And then as I become a writer in a very different way, I've still never had those experiences, but I've seen them enact, play out beautifully in her life and in her path. But the book has four different experiences where I'm writing or storytelling and basically lose it. I drop and I become this kind of animal, natural shaking. I lose time. I wonder, is that a possession? Is that what happened to mom? And I come to and I've told the story or I've written the thing. And the book also ends at the last instance of that, when I come to, I've written this play and I read it back and it's like, that's my language. I discovered my language. Mm.
The way you describe the sort of rawness and ugliness of writing, when you're just writing and you're getting it out, that's what people don't talk about. That's what people don't like when it's coming through you, that those moments are not something that is not romantic at all.
Yeah, it was super gnarly. It's like being, if you've ever surfed, I took a surfing lesson and it's like when you get caught in the undertow, you know, there are forces working upon you that you ain't nothing but a grain of sand caught in the undertow. You know, you connect with the forces of the world on a much larger scale. And so I never had that experience again. The book ends with the final one of my life. And then I go on to become a writer.
I love the, when she says that you were born, she saw like a light on you. Like she knew.
I thought when I got pregnant, this is not in the book. Everything I've been talking about is in the book, but this is just a little aside. So I always assumed when I got pregnant, I would therefore see the lights and it would be like a luminous experience.
Yes.
That was not the case. I was super shocked when I became pregnant. I didn't see it coming.
That's so funny. Have you ever asked your daughter if she has seen her ancestors?
I have asked my mom to kind of take charge of my daughter's spiritual life and education, and my son's also. And they've had some pretty extraordinary experiences. And I want them to have that experience on their own. I did a lot of, in this book, it shows my spiritual seeking too. I go from like the loud ass merengue dance party in North Philly to Quaker meeting on Sunday, where it's just quiet. Like how you worship, how you be is in total stillness and silence. Mm. So I have all these whiplash seeming contradictions in my life, but how could they be contradictions? Because they're all housed within me. Mm-hmm. That's always happening.
When you talk about your kids, you know, I think about that a lot with my kids and my parents, that one of the big motivations for me to have children too was like, I want my kids to know my parents. I want them to know how much of a force they really were so that they can take away what I can't give to my kids at all. That, you know, that smell of that Chinese food or feel of comfort or the stories that I don't know. It's like really, in a way, as storytellers, that both of us are, the greatest story that we're ever going to tell is what we tell the kids of how our kids of how the world is. Do we want them to be cynical? Do we want them to be optimistic? How much do we want to hide from them? And that's those are hard questions. Do you feel like this book is part of that?
Absolutely. And I have to say it's exhilarating and it's also scary. The notion of breaking old silences that we don't need to protect us anymore. Silence becomes a habit. Mm. It becomes a habit. And the act of breaking those silences, it creates a disruption in that habit, and habits are very hard to break and they're very painful to break. But I had to wait until I could really write these stories out of real advocacy. This is a book of advocacy. It's advocating for the honorable and flawed humanity of the family that I love. And when I knew it was coming from that place of honoring and advocacy, then I said, okay, I'm scared, but I'm gonna try to break some silences here. What if we do talk about our struggles? The media said one thing about our struggles. That does not reflect our truth. But I don't want to therefore pretend that we didn't face hardship. I want to address our humanity and the wholeness, the totality of our story. So, you know, that's why I dedicated the book to the female descendants of Obdulia Perez, who's my abuela Julia, past, present, and future. I want them to know our history without shame and with specificity, to know the cost of coming here to a new land and building new homes. And I want them to continue the work. Mm. You know, I want to create a foundation that they build upon to continue the work, to continue writing it down in the historical record.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, you live it. That's what's so beautiful about it. And that's why I feel like I came into your life at a moment where you were already growing this beautiful garden. And so it's like so wonderful to feel what happens when they all blossom right in front of your face. I'm watching, you know, 500 dancers and actors of Latinx descent, they're sweating and they're screaming and they're joyful and they have their flags, and you're like, you made that happen. Like, that is, you manifested that, and that's pretty beautiful. And that was the opposite of silence. You talk a lot about silence in this, and it resonates with me, because that's also the way a Chinese family is. Mm. You just sweep it under the rug and you keep on going, and then it never exists, but it always comes back. So it's very fascinating.
And it was a time of silence equals death. I mean, there were literally posters in Philadelphia plastered all over, silence equals death, silence equals death. Mm. And I was, I talk about in the book, I got trained to be a peer educator through the Red Cross. So I was a high schooler going into other high school health ed rooms, rolling condoms onto bananas saying, protect yourself. This is how you don't contract HIV. I didn't even realize how controversial that was. The year after I graduated, the Board of Ed disbanded that training program through the Red Cross, the peer training program against contracting HIV. So again, silence equals death. And as the same time I was like, you know, doing this, I had one family member who was my cousin, a little bit older than me, and he was my nanny. He came from Puerto Rico. I was a teenager. I didn't need a nanny, but it was a way to give him work and a way to house him and let him be who he was, which was a queer man, a queer Boricua man, which was not necessarily a safe place to be in that those times, but he was himself with us and I adored him. We had so much fun. We rented VHS tapes and he learned English watching, you know, Whoopi Goldberg, watching Eddie Murphy Raw. He learned very nasty English. And then he disappeared out of nowhere. And we didn't hear until after his passing that he had tested positive, had fled out of shame, because it was shameful in the community to many people at that time. And we never had a funeral for him. I mean, it was utterly, utterly devastating. You know, we loved him so much. That was a relationship just based on pure joy. And I admired how authentic and true he was to himself. And so in that case, I say in the book, you know, silence literally equaled death.
Yeah. And that part where you made sort of the world, the AIDS quilt for your high school, and you put his name on there, I think. And your mom was, you didn't know how to, you had everybody at the high school. Will you describe that story a little bit? Because it's so, and it's also heartbreaking at the end of that.
This was one of my funnest passages of the book to write, because it's one of the few times, the book is about me watching and spying on life, but being intimidated to step out into life because I think I'm not fluent in the language in the right way, or I don't move my body with the right body language. But this is a chapter in the book that I get over those fears and I have total agency and I just take action. So I decide after a series of funerals and not funerals, and after doing this Red Cross training and doing safe sex peer education at school, to do the Central High AIDS Quilt. I was very inspired by the National AIDS Quilt. And I was like, I can't just be me here. I went to Central High, there was thousands of students there. So I bring in all the fabric scraps along with my fellow peer educators. And people are stopping at lunch period. They're like, what's this all about? And we're like, if you know someone who passed from HIV or AIDS, make a square, name them, just make a square and honor them. And so, I mean, the AIDS quilt are grave sized quilts. Ours were, you know, 9 by 10 things. And we did this, more and more people came. We had a real patchwork ready. I didn't know how to sew them together. I realized that at the end, and I was intimidated to ask my mom, who was a master seamstress and had sewn all of these beautiful altars in our room, in our house. I was worried that AIDS quilt would be seen as a betrayal of the family's respectability or something. And so I didn't ask, and they just got pinned up on the bulletin board. So it was like an AIDS bulletin board. And then all of our club's materials got thrown away the next year and the club got disbanded.
I don't know why it was so, reading it was so heartbreaking to, because it felt like you were there, you were doing it, and then it just didn't go all the way through, so it just sort of.
But you know, it was beautiful. It was a good experience in terms of like, process is just as powerful as product, because it was really beautiful sitting there and like gluing feathers and glitter and sewing buttons with these other students who I'd never met because it's a big high school. And then we would just get to talking about what our experiences were with HIV and AIDS. And it was kind of nice. And I think I probably didn't talk too much to those students again because of, you know, hallway traffic and stuff. But it was nice to know, like, we're not alone. We're not alone. And I think when we tell our stories on a broader scale with honor and integrity, the realization of I'm not alone is one that spreads also.
And you really start gaining this sort of strength throughout. Like and the way you write is so cinematic. I mean, I don't know if that's the right word, but that's the world I come from. So I can see every moment. Like even when you're sort of, when you're talking about your dad and death of a salesman, and you start breaking down what we assume in our literature, what we are assuming in our own language. And I think that that's so fascinating. What you say, something about his average is so what, that he's average.
I think I was reading books at the time that were like Death of a Salesman, where a fairly like average guy was heroic and tragic because of the averageness. I don't know. It was really confusing to me. And at the same time, I was seeing very different examples of what a hero was, who were facing down real shitstorms of life and walking directly into the gale and doing it dancing and doing it playing bingo. And I was like, this to me, that's the hero I'm drawn to. Yeah. That's the hero that is interesting to me. But I loved Death of a Salesman too.
I mean, I feel like, I think you read The Crisis of Inconsequence is some, and to me, like, that's something I think we're teaching. I mean, that's what I was taught. Like, if you're not consequential, then you're nothing. And that's like our biggest fear. But your response is like, grab a shovel, sing a work song, build a throne that's real. Don't like, don't chase something that's not. I just think that's what you did. That's what so many people, when you realize that it's a fallacy, that you deserve something, that you need to like go get. I just think it was a beautiful sort of activation point. And to see you actually do it is pretty amazing. I know we're almost at a place where we have to take questions, but there's this one moment that is probably the most moving moment to me personally, was when you apologize to your mom about, because growing up, your parents speak broken English. And I remember I took French at school, and I would come home and I wouldn't understand a word of Chinese. And then they would say something, the moment I realized their grammar was wrong, and I would correct them.
Oh, I can't
take it. And I remember this feeling of being like cocky about it, like, no, you're saying it wrong. And now it hurts my heart so much about what it took for them to get here and to come into a new language. And I, the little brat,
yes,
is correcting them every second. And I don't know how to get, I don't know how to apologize for that.
It hits home so much what you're saying, John. And, one of the things I have come to learn as I spend every day with words and with language is that I was born into English. And so in that way, it was easy. It's like being born into money. You just get it for free. My mom had to earn English. She had to earn it. And in that way, her relationship with English is way more impressive and more real than mine. She wasn't born into it for free. When I realized that, I was like, damn, and I realized that a little bit with the narratives that are happening with immigration and documentation, where a lot of the research I did for our movie, when I was looking into the undocumented experience, was people who in the process of naturalization, they're like, I know so much more American history. They had to learn it for their quizzes. They had to make an oath about how American they are. And in that sense, I never did. I never had to prove anything. I was just born here. I just got it for free. And so I see my mom's English that way. And the other thing is, like, I now strive for language innovation as part of my creative process. And she deals with that every day because she is always in a process of translating in English. Her English is beautiful, by the way. And so in some ways I was like, she has it. She has it. I admire her English. Her English is special. And so I wanted to say that and to apologize for all the times that, because I got it for free, I made the erroneous and inaccurate assumption that I got it better.
I'm going to ask one more question before we turn it over. I'm sorry. It's only because of the transition from music to writing. I just loved that moment. Would you describe that a little bit? And I can't wait for everyone to read that.
So,
without ruining it for everybody.
In the first part of the book, I'm a child. And in the second part, I'm a young woman. And a pivot happens. My childhood is spent in my pursuit of language studies. Of music studies. I play piano. I love Chopin because I'm playing Chopin and I'm crying at the piano. It's a great outlet for my adolescent melancholy and depression. I go to Yale, creme de la creme, like super fancy school, get a music degree there. Then I come back to Philly at the time that the Roots had started this music movement called OK Player. I'm playing with, you know, John Legend. I'm playing, you know, at the same venue of Jill Scott. You know, this, I was on like a kind of yellow brick road here on music. Well, a music producer in Philly just looked me in the eye after he recorded some demos with me. And he was like, you're not good enough. And, you know, I get that people like want to prove their haters wrong, but actually something about what he said just rang a little true. And at the same time, my mom looks me in the face and she goes, you know, she's saying, why did you never pursue writing? You wrote all your life. I just assumed you would go on and keep writing. And I had never been self-aware. It was just, I mean, I breathed all my life too, but I didn't think I was gonna be a professional breather, you know? The second she said that, she said, you need to do it because you hold a lot of our history and you got the credentials to let those stories be heard. And she had participated in some of those silences that were really hard. And so here she was saying that she was asking me to break the silence. And also asking me to amplify the song at the same time. It wasn't just break silence, it was amplification. So I know we're supposed to go to the Q&A, but I did, the Seattle folks asked me to read a little passage. So I'm gonna read a very short passage that's about the music. So just to set this, it's just two paragraphs and just one paragraph, just to set the stage, I'm practicing in the living room, which is where the piano is. And in the next room over, the sunroom, is where mom's altars are, her lukumi thrones, to the different deities, which are basically source energies on earth. Like Jango, who is lightning, like Jemaja, who is the ocean, like Oshun and Babaluwade. So all of those altars are in the next room over. And here's what I say about this experience I have playing this Chopin nocturne. Over months and then years, the altars taught me how to pay attention and see them. On one occasion, I'd gotten so proficient at Chopin's nocturne in B flat minor that I could play it eyes closed without minding the fingering or keys. This allowed me to plunge into the song's eerie melancholy, and playing it left me emotionally raw, missing Dad so hard it hurt. With arm hairs raised and tears falling, I fled to the sunroom. The estera, the straw prostration mat, was rolled up in a corner. Just as I had seen mom do, I unrolled it, lay belly down before the orisha and shook the rattle. Just as I had heard mom do, I called out in a loud, intentional voice, like an arrow shot toward the sky. Elegua, I called out. Ololumare, Babaluaye, Jango, Oshun, Obatala, Ogun, Oya, thank you. I returned the mat to its proper place, then continued practicing Chopin. The orisha now lingered on my fingers, dancing with the nocturne. And I sensed the dawn of a real bilingualism, appropriate and specific to me.
Your writing is like this buttery paintbrush, and then you don't know, like three words can like sink you into this hole. It's like, it's crazy. I love your writing. It's so beautiful. Should we ask some of these questions?
Yeah, let's hear what's on everyone's mind.
Thank you both. Before we go to the questions, that was just such a beautiful, beautiful conversation. So thank you so much to both of you. It's, yeah, it's great. But we do have a lot of questions from the audience for both of you. And so I think we will start for, let's see. Well, here's a good one. Actually, I think this could be good for both of you. What's one piece of advice that you would give writers of color or immigrants trying to get in publishing or film industries? So I don't know if either of you have any thoughts about that.
Go ahead, Quiara.
You know, I guess two things. One is when people are making offers to you, I mean, it starts out with you're banging down people's doors looking for any opportunity. And there's a moment when you have to kind of say yes to almost anything just to get your work out there, put your work out there. I mean, never, never, you know, put yourself in a degrading situation, of course. But I would say something that has been continuously helpful for me is just always touch in every day with your purpose, with the why. That will help make informed decisions in the actual creative process, and also as you meet collaborators and make business decisions, just always touch in. There are some answers that have stayed consistent over my life, and there's some answers that changed, but being clear of my purpose has been very helpful. And the other one I would give is that it can be hard and it can feel isolating. And in the spirit of knowing that you're not alone, find wellness practices that involve other artists of color. That will be uplifting and you'll know, okay, I'm not in this alone.
I love in the book when you talk about finding your like group, your rebellious little group that can fight together and, you know, be mischievous together.
Yes, yes.
John, do you have any thoughts about that, or should we move on to the next question?
I mean, I would say the same thing. I think that it's like, you know, what fulfills you. And sometimes at first, it just needs to be learning the craft. It took me 10 years to learn how to make a movie, because you can't learn how to make a movie unless you're making movies. And I made 6 movies and I loved every single one of them, but I was learning how to work the knobs. And then once I learned to work the knobs, then I was, and luckily I survived working the knobs. It didn't crush me. Then I was like, oh, but what do I want to say? Why am I working the knobs? And that changed me. That was, maybe that was only 4 or 5 years ago. And that's when I went looking for stuff that only, that I knew only I could make, that was going to be, that at a level that I had already earned a certain thing in the studio level so I could get movies made, but what kind of movies could only I get made now? And that really changed me, and now informs everything I do.
Thank you. That's both of great advice from both of you. Thank you. This question from Linda is for Quiara. Are there any family members that have influenced the In the Height characters?
Definitely. My pop, who is one of the characters in my book, In My Broken Language, that who is a really fun character to write. He's a very larger than life sort of personality. He directly influenced Kevin Rosario because he is a businessman in the community and has had a lot of ups and downs over the years, and is also a respected figure in the community, and that comes with responsibility. And so he's one of the direct influences.
That's great. We have another couple questions about In the Heights, both and the movie specifically. So let's see. How did you know that you wanted to create something like In the Heights? I think that's probably, it looks like it's for John, but I think both of you could address that. And then I'm gonna mention the other parts. It's a multi-part question. How hard was it to bring other Latinx characters into the spotlight? And how was it for the public? How did they respond? And then finally, John, did you learn Spanish while doing the movie? That's from a different attendee.
I would embarrass myself if I showed the Spanish that I learned, so we won't go there. But go ahead, Kara, about the other thing.
Oh, I was gonna throw it to you, but how did I know I wanted to make In the Heights? I really loved writing out of the community. So it was another community story. In this case, it was a multi-generational, which was of a lot of interest to me. And I liked the notion of the two lead characters being a young man who stays home and a young woman who gets out, and what those narratives, what's traditionally put on those narratives. I'm talking about Nina and Usnavi. I'm very much Nina. You know, Usnavi's the one who stays, Nina's the one who goes, but what does that really mean? What does getting out even imply about your loved ones that you grew up with? Is it actually like derogatory even as a phrase and as a notion, getting out? So I was like, let's chop it up, let's go deep. I wanna tell these two stories. They came up together. What are their different paths gonna be?
Mm-hmm. What's beautiful about Kiara's writing too, and I felt this is what attracted me to the show as well, is that there is no villains. Like, they're not fighting against the mayor who's trying to take over the blocks. It's like, it's all everyone's inner struggles, and their dreams are big and their conflicts are big. Even though you may walk past that bodega and not think one moment about that person who's working there, that person has a life and dreams that are bigger and deserve more than any main character in a movie ever told. And I loved that, that's what I learned from Lynn and Quiara through this. And when they took me around their neighborhood in Washington Heights, I got to meet those people and I got to learn about them. And they both invited me and welcomed me into their homes, but also yelled at me on the street when we were blocking their parking. Just like family. When my mom came to visit, we were doing a big dance number on the street. And I said, "Mom, sit here," because she's mischievous as well. "I just stay here. Don't move. I got to shoot this." When I come back, she's gone. And she's drinking beers with the family right up in the window above because they saw her sitting there. Like, "You can't leave your mom there. We're having a great time." And that's the kind of place that I loved. And so the thing that drew me to it from the very beginning was seeing it as a show on Broadway years ago. I mean, this is 12 years ago, maybe. And seeing my family in it, even though it had nothing to do with my family or where I was a California boy with my, you know, my Chinese family. But I knew that abuela. I knew that what it felt like to have your cousins and your aunts and uncles weighing this thing on you, and you didn't know what to do. And everyone had different answers. So I love that we got to paint that. You're on mute, Stefan. Of course.
Of course. Thank you to both of you for that. Quiara, here's another one for you. What was the biggest difference between writing plays and writing your memoir? And did you struggle to allow yourself to be the main character?
I think because the plays have used other people as inspiration, I felt more protective of those characters in my plays. I don't feel protected. You know, you can call me a name, all right, fine, I'll get grumpy and move on. You're gonna call my cousin a name or my sister a name, we have to talk. This will be addressed immediately. So, you know, I was very protective in the plays in a way that I wasn't naturally of myself. I just thought, if I'm gonna do this, I have to go deep. So, and I have to be real. I tried to really interrogate myself in a way I would not let myself interrogate characters in plays based on other family members. And I hope I was successful in that, not trying to be self-aggrandizing, but trying to be honest about times I was a successful person and times I failed as a person in my coming of age.
Yeah, that seems fair. It's a vulnerable position to be in writing a book like this.
And what was cool is like you really have teeth in this. Like, you know, in a movie, you have to sort of like tap on it and you got to move on because the things got to keep going. In this, you really get to we feel your bite. I'm jumping up and down. I'm crying. I'm blushing at moments. I'm like, is this the Quiara I know? Oh my god! Like, and I wish I listened only to the audiobook for the last 2 chapters just because I wanted to experience it. And I actually am going to go back and listen to the whole thing like that, because you hearing the words said properly and hearing your voice is a totally different experience. So I'm excited to go back actually.
Yes, for all those watching, I did the audiobook. So yeah, that's another way. And I just had this memory pop up from doing the audiobook. DMX has a little cameo in it. And wow. He said, "Well, you can't sing the lines." I used to sing my sister like my own version of a DMX song to praise her body, her round body. And for the audiobook, they're like, "You can't sing it." And I said, "No, I have to sing the DMX, or we have to take it out, because otherwise it just sounds like mockery, you know?" I don't know why that just came to mind. And, you know, rest in peace, DMX. Mm-hmm.
So we have one last question here. I'm going to combine a couple questions here that are about the writing process. And then I have a few comments that I'd like to share with you, just because I know that you can't see them, you know, while you're doing the event. But so we've got a couple questions asking, do you consider yourself an introvert or extrovert? And does that apply to your writing as well? Does writing energize or exhaust you? And then what is your mode of writing, when, where, and how? So.
I consider myself an introvert and an extrovert. I love being in the company of other people. I I'm not delusional about that. I think John would probably second that, but it does also exhaust me. So like, I need to run away and be in my family for real. Like, I will be in my writing studio by myself for a month straight, and that is perfectly fine with me. So that's, writing's fun because I can go into my writing cave and then I go onto set or I go into the rehearsal room. I get the best of both worlds. I'm skipping a question, something about writing process. What was the middle question there?
It was basically, did you feel like being an introvert or extrovert applied to your writing? Does it energize you or drain you?
And then writing is totally draining for me. I mean, being a person is totally draining for me. I don't understand how someone like Lin-Manuel has like wakes up with that energy, continues with that energy and goes to sleep with that energy. That is foreign to me. Life is exhausting, and what I do to energize myself is I take walks, I go to the museum, I listen to music. So this has been a somewhat exhausting year because a lot of the things I do to energize myself and get my energy up, I can't do safely. I really look forward to moving on and getting to do, I do this walking meditation where I look at people's faces. In New York, there's so many beautiful faces, and I really miss seeing people's faces.
Kiara's an introvert, but she loves people more than, like, genuinely loves to be around people and with people more than, you know, us, you know, who actually pretend to like people more. So it's a really cool mix. That was a really good question because I can't put my finger on it fully, but you explained it perfectly.
So John, you think you're an extrovert, yeah?
I mean, I act like an extrovert, but I am... I don't know. That's a hard question. Okay. I'm from a big family, so I'm used to chaos around me, but I like the walls that I can go into my room and close the door and hear the action, but not be in the action. Mm-hmm. I hate being isolated though. So I guess that makes me sort of more of an extrovert. I mean,
okay. We won't hold you to what you both say tonight. So, you know. So we have a couple just beautiful comments that I wanted to share with you both while we're here tonight. So the first one is from, I believe, somebody named Ada. As a first generation Puerto Rican myself, your family story resonates with me. What I admire about our culture is the resilience, joy, optimism, and hope. My hope is that these positive virtues are passed on to the next generation. We need to keep the language and culture and pass it on, whether we do it through story, music, theater. Let's pass it on. Gracias for your book and for sharing your story. So that's a beautiful
Wait comment. Until you see what Kiara does in the Heights. If you like that trailer, every line is from her heart. Like, that is her. That is absolutely, I look at every line, I'm like, that is Kiara. It's so beautiful what she puts on there. And anyway, that's, I hope, yes.
And remind us, when does the movie become available for the public? Those of us that aren't involved in the making of it?
June 11th in theaters or in HBO Max. If you feel comfortable, go to the theater. It's fun with a group of strangers, socially distanced, far away,
safer, masked. Yes.
but it's, you know, it's a community movie, so it's cool. But if you don't feel safe, watch it at home.
Yeah, with your yeah, maybe on a Zoom or a text chain or something. Yeah. we have another comment from Mahal. I have no question, but I am Borakua, raised in Cleveland, Ohio, and grew up with clairvoyance on my mom's side. So relatable, not Orisha, but surrounded by people who are deeply involved with them. So I think that resonated there too.
And then, a little, like, vocab glossary moment. The word is Boricua, which is
Boricua.
It indicates someone from Puerto Rico, but Boriqueng is the Taino word for the island. So Boricua is a very proud and a very culturally proud way to say, you know, Puerto Rican.
Excellent.
Can you imagine me? I got to learn so many lessons throughout about Taino, the story of that, what sauces, what sauces to bring to a dinner party, how they bring it, do they make it at home, put it in their back pocket, how people sit and serve food at a dinner table. I mean, every ounce of it, and Kiara and Lynn, they never made me feel stupid. I could ask any stupid question. Like, it's the best friend you could ever have to be like, so how does that work? What's the issue with that? Why am I, is this okay? Like, I think that's what we need in this world, for people to be open to educating and learning and asking questions, because I think people are nervous that they're wrong. And I was wrong many times, but when you have friends that extend a hand and guide you through that, and you never do it again, it's like, it's very, yeah, it's very inspiring and wakes you up.
Yeah, and that's how we learn, right? Yeah. You know, so thank you for that. So we have one last comment from Sreniti. Thank you so much for hosting. I'm such a big fan of both of you. John, you did amazing movies and The Greatest Director, and I've followed you for a while. I'm so thankful. So that's a nice little thank you for that. But I am so grateful to both of you for being here tonight. This is just such a joy to hear you talk and be vulnerable with us in this space. And I'm so grateful to both of you. Can't wait to see the film. Can't wait to read or listen to My Broken Language. And for those of you that are interested in reading Quiara's book, it's available through Elliott Bay Book Company. They're open for limited browsing, curbside pickup, and delivery. You can find that at their website, elliottbaybook.com, or you can look for it at the library's website, spl.org, and we're putting those links in the chat as well.
And I'm sending it to 10 friends tonight. I just can't. It is a gift, literally a gift.
You're Oprah-ing my book. Thank you.
Oh, I love it. You know, buy one and pass one on, right?
Yeah, seriously.
Right.
Yeah, and I signed the books that get purchased from Elliott Bay. So.
That's great. I see that in the chat now. Our colleagues at Elliott Bay are saying that there are signed book plates available through their store. So if you want to get a book signed by Quiara, you can call Elliott Bay or order online and let them know in the notes field that you want a signed copy. So thank you so much for being here, both of you. And for those of you that have joined us tonight, we'd love to hear your thoughts about programming at the library. So we'll put a link to the survey. If you can take a minute and answer that, cut and paste that link into your browser and take a minute after the event, that'd be great. You guys, I wish we could just hang out, you know, like we were bemoaning the fact that we can't just chill and gossip after the event's over. So sure. Thank you so much for being here. We're grateful to all of the folks that made tonight's program possible: Elliott Bay Book Company, Intimon Theater, Seattle Repertory Theater, and our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, and the Seattle Public Library Foundation. And of course, thanks to all of you for joining us tonight and asking your wonderful questions. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you all next time.
Thank you. Thanks, Cara.
Good night.